tell you what I have come to believe about verses 7 and 8. And this, I'm not writing a new commandment, on the other hand, I am. I think he's referring back to that commandment that Jesus talked about, that he recorded in the Gospels, where Jesus says, a new commandment I give unto you. John wrote about that. And I think he was saying, I'm not giving you a new commandment, but on the other hand, there is a new commandment that we've been given. And it's one of love, that we love one another. You know, there's a lot of sin that lies in not loving one another. What does it mean to love one another? Does that mean that you put your arm around and shake hands with them, or give them a hug at church, or and tolerate them the rest of the week? No. The Bible says, and Jesus said, love is when you are willing to lay down your life for your brother, for your sister. Laying down your life. We need to go through every day of our life willing to sacrifice whatever we need to sacrifice for our brothers and for our sisters and for our church, because that's how we demonstrate love. Otherwise, it isn't love. It's convenience and politeness. You know, a lot of what we think we're doing as love is just simple manners and politeness. Because, well, I don't want to be mean to anybody, but boy, if I wanted to say what I really meant, I'd give them a mind or two. No. Love is to genuinely lay down your life for whoever needs help, for whoever is within your scope or your realm of influence. That's not necessarily evil. Easy to do. It's not necessarily pretty either. But it's what love is all about. I want you to look at verse 9. The one who says he is in the light and yet hates his brother is in the darkness until now. If you hate your brother, it means you're in darkness. Now, he has just spent the entire first chapter telling us the difference between light and darkness. And how God wants us, remember the 3 points last week? God is light. Remember? We are to live in the light, and we are to walk in the light. Remember? But here he's saying, if we hate one another, we are in darkness. That means that our actions reveal what's going on in our heart. It's exactly what it means. We're supposed to love one another, not hate one another. We're supposed to love one another and help one another and be there for one another. And what, you know, the interesting thing is, when you see it, you know it's really love. And when you see it and it's not really love, it really isn't love. There is a distinction just like light and darkness. And that's the message here that John continues to demonstrate to us, that we cannot be people who hate one another. Even somebody who is probably the worst sinner in the world, whoever that could possibly be, it might be me. We're even supposed to love them. Think about all the people that we've read about in the news. All the people that we've heard on the news, film at 11, that have done ugly things to people and to our society and generally, are we supposed to love them too? Yes. Yeah. That doesn't mean that we have to like what they do. It may even mean, and if you want to split a hair, it may even mean we don't like them very much. Love them in Jesus. You see the difference? We love them in Jesus. I wish I could love everybody the way God wants me to love everybody. I can't. Half the time, I can't even love myself. Right, Dick? Right? Half the time, I can't even love myself. But I can love myself. I can love others. I can even love people that have done heinous things. I can love them in Jesus. Because Jesus has given me the capacity to do that. He's given you the capacity to do that. And it is a supernatural thing that takes place as we love one another. But hatred is not in that list. Hatred has no place. Now, hatred takes in a great deal of things. Treating somebody badly. Leaving them out of the circle, so to speak. Ignoring them. Putting them down. Laughing about them. Joking about them. All of that comes under the heading of hatred. And if we do those things, God says, that's living in darkness. And here we've just heard in chapter 1 how important it is to cross from darkness into the light. We are children of light. Children of light. And God has called us to be children of light. To reflect the light of His Son Jesus. Walk in the light, He told us, remember? Now look at verse 10. The one who loves his brother abides in the light. And there is no cause for stumbling in him. Now you know what? He seems to be saying, and the treatise here seems to be going, if we love properly and conduct ourselves in Christian love, if we walk in the light, if we know clearly how God is guiding us in the light, we won't stumble. He will just lead us in the light, and we'll know what to do, we'll know what to say. But if we do stumble, I mean, He doesn't want us to stumble, but if we do stumble, are we forgiven? Of course we are. Of course we are. And we do stumble, don't we? I do. But there's a difference in stumbling from time to time and walking a life that stumbles all the time from situation to situation. You see the difference? Now I want you to look at verse 11. But the one, now he summarizes here, but the one who hates his brother is in the darkness. We just covered that. And walks in the darkness. And does not know where he is going because the darkness has blinded his eyes. Ultimately, if you walk in darkness, if you walk in sin, if you walk in hatred, and you live that kind of lifestyle, whatever it happens to be, you become blind to what is wrong. And you don't even know you're walking that way. And you go through life blindly stumbling along, not even knowing that you're out of God's will. I have talked to people before that had so many, had so many axes to grind about so-and-so that did this to me, and so-and-so that did that to me, and I'll never go there again because they said this to me. And I'll never do that again because nobody appreciated it when I did it. And on and on. And the hatred builds up. And the anger builds up. And before long, they are so blind, they don't even see the light. They don't even see the light. And they don't even see the truth anymore. You follow what I'm saying? We can cause ourselves to be sucked into a funnel of darkness that takes us into blindness that we don't even see what's going on around us. Or how we're acting, or how we've come to believe. There is a song that I love to sing, that we need to sing sometimes, Todd. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord.
Yes.
Have you heard that song?
Yes.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Because we need God to open our eyes so that we can see spiritually. Some people, like my brother David here, who cannot see physically, can see more spiritually than many people can see physically. You see what I'm saying?
Amen.
Opening the eyes to our heart is a light to our heart that gives us the guidance that God will provide for us as we go down the path that He has for us. So where are we here? What does John say? How do we cut through all of this? Just as there is a difference between light and darkness, as he's already shown us, our actions, our walk, reveal who and what we really are. So you say you're a Christian. So you say you're a believer. So you say you love Jesus. So you say you go to church. Are you really in the will of God? See the difference? To be in the will of God, we have to be obeying Him, trusting Him, walking in the light, following His direction. Our actions and our walk reveal who and what we really are, what we believe, who we are, and ultimately where we're going. I used to be an associate pastor years ago at a church in Anaheim called Crescent Baptist Church in Anaheim. I was the associate pastor there. I did music and I did youth and music guy. I was there for about 6 years. And our church secretary was a real sweet lady, fine Christian lady, had a brother. And she said, yeah, my brother used to teach Sunday school class. I said, really? Here at this church? And she says, oh yeah, he had a big adult class. And I said, well, how come he doesn't come anymore? He said, because the people didn't appreciate him. What was he hung up on? You see what I'm talking about? And I went and visited him. And he said, I will never set foot into that church again. And I said, what? He said, you'll never see me there again. And I remember, and I was much younger then, maybe more impressionable than I am now, I don't know. But I remember leaving there and thinking to myself, how sad is that? How sad is that? Here is a man who was a teacher. He obviously knew some things from God's Word. Obviously. But he had never learned how to apply them to his life. We need, you know the old saying, practice what you preach? We need to practice what we preach. Amen? Amen. I suppose if I were to summarize and give the overall stamp on this of what John is saying to us today is, he says, Jesus has told us to love one another. There is nothing else for us to do except love one another. If we love one another, everything else will fall in place. Won't it? Will it? Amen. Will it? Amen. If we love one another, will everything fall in place? Amen. Absolutely. That's what the Bible's telling us right here. It affects our walk. It affects our attitude. It affects what we say, what we do, where we go. If we love as Jesus taught us to love, everything will fall in place. So, how's things going in your life today? Are you struggling with anything in your life that you're not sure what to do about? Don't feel bad, folks. I am. I have struggles every day of my life. What to do about this? I don't even know why God even puts up with me. I'm serious. I am not kidding. I don't even know why God even puts up with me sometimes. I thank God that He called me and that He somehow managed to use me in some small way here or there. But I am so grateful that He's chosen me. And if you are a believer and Jesus is in your heart and you have been forgiven of your sins, He's chosen you too. In fact, you know what? He's chosen all of us. But not all have responded. You see what I'm saying? He's chosen all of us, but not all of us have responded. Today, in a moment, we're going to have an invitation. And I'm going to ask you to stand in a moment. And I just want you to pray. And I want you to just say, God, Am I where you want me to be in my life? Lord, am I living the kind of life you want me to be? Am I the husband you called me to be? Am I the wife you called me to be? Am I the deacon you called me to be? Am I the leader you called me to be? Am I the Christian you called me to be? You know where I'm going with all this. In other words, Lord, speak to me if there's something I need to change in my life. Speak to me if something isn't right that somehow I've missed. Or there may be that glaring thing in your life that you just ignore. Because we all have those too. But the one good thing about it all, there never has to be a doubt that Jesus loves us. Ever. And we never have to doubt that he will never leave us nor forsake us. Let's stand together, shall we? Would you stand with me, every head bowed and every eye closed? Bow your heads, please, for a moment. Whatever it is that's on your heart, whatever God's word has touched in your life, whatever God seems to be saying to you right now with your head bowed during this quiet time, just say, God, I'm willing to do whatever you want me to do. God, I'm willing to say whatever you want me to say. Help me to do it as unto the Lord. Help me to do it in the name of Jesus. If you are here today and you've never received Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you've never invited him into your heart in the forgiveness of sin, you need to pray that prayer right where you are right now. And to say, God, oh God, I know I'm lost. I know I need you in my life. I invite Jesus into my heart right now. I receive him as my Lord and as my Savior. And I want to obey you. Today, I commit myself to becoming a Christian. Maybe you want to join this church. Maybe you want to rededicate your life. Whatever it happens to be, I'm going to invite you to do whatever you need to do. Father, be with us as we enter into this time of contemplation and invitation. Help us to do what you've called us to do, what you've asked us to do. In Jesus' name I pray.